It is great to be with you today. If you're with us, say, I'm here. Fantastic. We're stand on up. We're going to sing a song that I thoroughly enjoyed. Perfect for today. Today's Parents' Friends Day. And this song is Friend of God. We're going to sing the chorus a little bit later. It says, I am a friend of God. You are a friend of God. Sing it with us this morning.
Lord of glory, you have called me friend.
good singing. I think it's awesome that we come together on Friends Day and we start off singing this very simple concept in the Bible that says, "You, God, call me a friend." What a great opportunity to fellowship together today. Shake hands with the other friends. Make new friends. There's Darth Vader over here. There's a nun back over here. There's tigers over here. Princess is up front. Meet everybody. Shake hands. We'll come back to sing in a little bit.
To welcome you to Let's Make a Deal. You want to make a deal? Anybody want to make a deal today? That's it. That's it. You guys are... All right, look. This is the saddest Let's Make a Deal crowd I've ever hosted for. I'm Monty Hall, the host of Let's Make a Deal. I did dress up today. I dressed up as my dad or pastor, whatever. I dressed up like a preacher. If you're visiting with us today, I am Jeff Wilson. I am the lead pastor here, and I do not wear suits, so this is a real treat. I am dressed up today in costume, and so I'm glad you're here. A lot of you came out dressed up and ready to Let's Make It. What in the world is going on? In the middle of a production. Don't mind me. I'm just hosting a game show. Don't worry about it. Good grief. All right, if that graduate wins anything, we're going to remove her name immediately. So let me go ahead and get this game show started. Welcome to Friends Day and welcome to Let's Make a Deal, Kings Mountain Church of the Nazarene style. So I'm excited you're here. All right, they're still coming in. So let me just have you stand if you attend here regularly and you brought with you today at least three visitors. Stand up. If you have at least three, okay. Oh, it's going to be a fight. That's it. All right, how many we got? All right. Stay standing if you have five visitors with you today. Hey, bright idea. Are you still standing over there? Yeah, she's got a bright idea. She's going to lie about how many visitors she brought. I know how that works. We busted you. Christine, how many do you have with you? Five. Anybody here beat five? Nobody here? Christine, come on down. You're the first one to make a deal today. Yes. Now listen here, back up. I don't want you shaking it or sniffing these prizes or anything like that. Come over here with me. You got to have an audience participation, okay? You now have the opportunity to take what is in box number one or the envelope that I hold in my hand. Whoa, that's right. This could be a good prize. This could be a zonk, all right? Either here, this could be $100 right here. The box could be a zonk. I tell you what, pick one of your visitors to come down, one of your visitors by name to come on down here today and join you.
Come on, boy.
All right. There you go. All right. Now, Blaine, come on down. You are going to get, what do you call this lady right here?
Grandma.
Okay, we'll call her grandma too. Okay. You dress as a grandma today. Okay. I tell you what, you look good. All right, Blaine, I'm going to give you the opportunity. You can get whatever Grandma doesn't pick. So, Grandma, you can have what's in this envelope or in box number one. Help her out, audience. What does she need to grab? Box or this envelope? Take the box or the envelope. What you got? You want? All right, the box is yours. All right. Blaine, do you want what's in this? I wrapped up some weights. That's good. Do you want what's in this envelope? Or I'll give you $20 to sit down right now and just forget this game ever existed. But stay in church. I don't want you to leave this. Oh, that's a five. What? That's a five. That's for another game right there. Watch out. You're going to take the envelope and pass up. This is $20. I'm not one of those preachers. I promise. This is $20 right here. $20? You're going to take the envelope? Should I do that? Is that a good move? All right. All right. There you go. Open it up. You can see what you got. Let the people know. They want to know. You passed up a crisp, well, kind of a crisp $20 bill. it's broken. Good thing I got a receipt on that. Whew, Christine, you want to? How about this? I'll give you $5 not to drop it again, and let Blaine open it up, and trade with Grandma too. Give her that. All right, you get that one, Blaine. Trust me, your grandma doesn't even know what she just threw on the ground and tried to destroy. all right, so Christine dressed up as a grandma today, and she got $25 to, it's not just Olive Garden, there's a whole bunch on there. And then she attempted to break by slamming very hard onto the ground Blaine's gift of an Amazon Echo. So congratulations for that, Blaine. You don't even know what that is, Grandma. Just go sit down. Don't worry. Don't even worry about it. Blaine, you can school her later on what that is. Man, I tell you what, that's why I don't dress up like a preacher. It is hot up here. It is hot up here. I tell you what, is there anybody else in the religious profession here today that would come on down? Anybody else that is serving in the church, preferably the Catholic Church? Maybe they are in a full-on habit today and have their rosary beads around there. If she doesn't even know who I'm talking to. Okay. All right, let's try that. How about anybody that's working for the dark side? All right, so we are going to have a little game here between a nun, but she's a little scared. So anybody here with a, come on down. Come on down, dark side. The force is strong with this one. Not you. You were afraid to even come on down. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. All right. You ever trip Darth Vader again when he's trying to get down front? All right. Dun, 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 dun. Come on, Faudis. Dun, dun, dun. Anybody know Star Wars? All right, never mind. It's too late now. He's already down here. All right. First person that can, and you get ready. Can you move in that? Get up? Oh, never mind. Okay. All right. I was going to say, first person that can get a comb and raise that comb in the air, so either Sister Gimple here or the Dark Lord himself, Darth Vader, can get to. Darth Vader, you lost. You lost on that one, Darth Vader. You lost on that one. But, Nun, I'm going to give you a chance right here. I'm going to give you a chance to, don't be peeking.
I'm not peeking.
You're a dishonest nun. Stand out there. I know he's going to cheat, but he's Darth Vader. He is Darth Vader. All right. You have the option of choosing first between what's in behind bag number two or what's behind bag number three. Those are not the bags you want. Or I'll give you $20 to take neither prize. I'll let Darth Vader choose first, and then we'll let whoever handed you the comb come up here and make a choice. There's some nice prizes still out there on the table. Don't get to look. Whoa, whoa, I hand you the bags.
I touched you.
You host next year. You host the next time. You want prize number two or three? What?
Three.
Curtain three. Curtain three. Curtain three. All right, so that's going to be for you. Darth Vader, I give you $50 to sit down, or you can take your chances at what's behind curtain number two or bag number two. Oh, man, you are. I'm not promising you that. You want the money, or do you want to?
Let's go with number two.
Okay. Sweet. All right, Terry, did you really have a comb in your purse today? Nice. I got you. I thought you were there. Come on up, Panther fan. Come on up. All right. Do you want $50 or do you want to take a chance at one of these two prizes that they're holding?
$50.
Whose kid is this? You sure you're not going to pass up what's one of these bags here?
I'd rather have
bag number three?
Oh, no.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
$50. All right, go sit down. All right. Jackie, open up what you got. Let's see what you got. I did the taping job and everything on that for you. Ooh, nice. Do you want to slam it on the ground first, like Christine, or do you want to see what's in there? All right, you're welcome to do either. I don't even know. This is where it gets exciting. Oh, all right. Sorry. Sorry, Darth Vader. Open up what you got in bag number two. Let's see what you got. Oh, a Zonk. All right. Yes. You passed up a Fitbit or $50, but this is a lint magic self-cleaning lint brush. That is not bad. That is not bad. Not bad. All right. Hang on. Wait, Darth Vader. I'm not that. I'm a good guy. I want you to come back to church. There's $20 for at least participating. You look good. You're making me sweat just watching. All right. I'm out of cash, but I have one gift left. Audience, this is your opportunity. If you are in a costume and have not already won a prize, could you just come and stand down front? We want to see everybody and cheer and clap real loud for you. I know I have the best costume on today, but there's some pretty good second or runner-up costumes. Violin tight. Come all the way down here, too. This is not just the only costume section. This side here accepts costumes down here. We got sock monkey pajamas. They just rolled out of bed. We got some outlaws. Oh, wait, Atlanta Braves fan, you got to sit down. We don't allow that here. That's crazy. What do you think, Willie? Willie, come on up here. Help us out. This is Willie from Duck Dynasty. Come on, Willie. This is Willie from Duck Dynasty. He's already got the best gift ever. He got to drive a bunch of teenagers 6 hours yesterday, so he's not getting a gift today. But I do.
I rode. That credit goes to Dallas.
Oh, that's right. Well, he dressed up like a youth leader. You dressed up like Willie from Duck Dynasty. All right, so audience participation. Willie here is going to go down on that end, and he's going to put a hand over somebody's head. You cheer for him if you think they're in the best costume here today. We'll start down to my right. That is a candy wrapper down there, a candy wrapper. She'll drop some sick beats on you when you're ready after church. Go ahead, Willie. Come on this way with your hand over their head. You all that didn't dress up in costume now get to vote for the best costume out here, so cheer real loud. Let's start with a candy wrapper. Come on down. Let's hear it for candy wrapper. All right. Hey, if you're from Kings Mountain and proud, we have a mountaineer down here, so let's hear it for a mountaineer. Oh, I didn't even see Pablo Picasso. I'm sorry, Pablo Picasso, that's an artiste right there. All right, and her mean dad, that'll put you in a full Nelson afterwards. What wrestler are you? He's just a bad dude, all right? T-Rex, big head and little arms. There we go, T-Rex. We got some superheroes right here. We got Captain America and, wait, Batgirl and Captain America girl. All right, let's hear about it. Hey, this is the first bright idea Becky Collins has had all year. She dressed up. All right. We have an Olympic swimmer. You're going to hear from her in a minute, but we got an Olympic swimmer right here. All right. Hey, wait, who's down here? You got to help me out now. We got a mom, right? Who's this Obi-Wan Kenobi right here? Jacob. Man, I like it. That's a Bible character, and I thought he was from Star Wars. Good job. I can't see down there. So who you got with you? Ruth? Naomi? Oh, no, karate. Okay. Hey, you got it right here. She will take me out. Spider-Man. All right, the oldest graduate. We'll celebrate her next week. I don't know what's going on with this cool guy. Oh, a lifeguard. Hey, all right. We got a panther right here. Some beauty queens. Come on, keep cheering. Hey, we got the ladies soccer team right here. Am I right? Tell me it's soccer. Ooh, looking good. All pretty up here. This is a model right here. I know that. Are you a Dallas Cowboy? Oh, no. This is Cam Newton. I did not mean to say that. That's Cam Newton right here. All right, let's hear it for Cowgirl Fran. She rode in on her horse, whatever that is. All right, we got a pair of poodle skirts here. They're going to sock hop later. That's my kid who raided my closet. He stole my shades and sweet jacket. We got some, let's hear it for that, some sock monkeys in their pajamas. Hobo Joe, do we hear it for Hobo Joe? All right, and then the outlaws down here. All right, which outlaw is better than the other? Let's hear it for our first outlaw. He's riding the dirt bikes. And then this guy came in on the baddest moped in town right there. Look out. All right. And then Chipper Jones down at the end. Yeah, Chipper Jones. All right, who do we got? Who did you hear the loudest cheer for? Bright Idea. Bright Idea, come on down. Hey, the rest of you look good. Congratulations. You did a great job. Listen here. It wasn't. I don't have any more money because I'm flat broke, but I have this gift, and I guarantee some people in here will give you some money for it. So go ahead, open it up, let them see what you got, because I know there's some people here that have been drooling and waiting to hear about this gift. I'll just go ahead and tell you why I open it up. It is 12 of my best sermons on 8-track. So you know what an 8-track is. You know what an 8-track is. She said it's not big enough for an 8-track. We just went right over. This went right over your head. This is modern technology. What is it?
It's a GoPro.
It's a GoPro. Bright idea. We got a GoPro. And I have a whole bag full of accessories for that GoPro, which is all kinds of stuff. Well, you'll see. I'll get it to you later, all right? All right, if anybody wants that GoPro, she doesn't know what they're worth, so offer her $25. You might get out of here with that today. I'm just kidding. She's got a bright idea. You guys look great. Thank you for coming out and being a part of Friends Day. Let me tell you, right after this service, and we are going to worship in just a few moments, I'm going to get out of my pastor get up so I can worship with you. This microphone is the stickiest thing I've ever held on. Ooh. And that is my pet peeve. I'm about to go crazy up here because I got sticky fingers. Listen, we are going to have a wonderful time of worship, and we're glad that you're here. Again, thanks for visiting with us. We are also going to celebrate our loving Lord and Savior today. We're just going to thank him so much for the opportunity he's given us here. At least the sanctuary is air-conditioned, okay? Praise the Lord. All right, the AC and the foyer broke, so after service, just run through there. Just run right through there as quick as you can. And on your way through there, hang a left when you get outside, and we have a pavilion. It's right down in that back corner. We want to just thank you so much and bless you with a lunch today, okay? And if the weather holds, we'll hang out there a little bit longer and maybe play some cornhole, and the kids will set up that bouncy house if the weather's going to hold. But if not, we still want you to get a plate of food, all right? And just thanks for being here. We're so excited that you are here. I need to invite up the best Olympic swimmer that I've ever met in my entire life. She has won gold in the 500-meter dog paddle and the, what was the other one?
The high dive.
Oh, the high belly flops. That's right. So we don't believe you. So at the kids' pool party on June the 25th, we want you to show us, okay?
I'll be there.
Say, listen, this is Pam McSwain. She is in charge of our discipleship ministries here at the church, and she has been working hard on what to do with all of us this summer so that we continue to draw closer to the Lord and to grow in our faith. And she's going to share a little about what's going to be happening Sunday evenings. It's combined for all of us, intergenerational. And this is Gary Cummings. He has won, what did you win gold in, Gary?
Jogging.
All right, yeah. You jog up here in a minute. All right. So she's going to tell us about this summer. If you're visiting with us, we'd love to have you come back. It's an intergenerational time, youngest to the oldest. That's not me. Whoa. Oh, you have it all written down?
I have it. I got this.
Sweet. Hey, listen, I'm preaching out of Mark 10 today. I'm going to go worship with everyone, all right? And you
okay.
Have a good time. Thank you.
I got it. Don't worry.
I'm not
this
changing.
This summer, Jeff is actually going to be preaching on Hebrews 11 and going to talk about the fathers of our faith and all those great heroes of our faith. Then on Sunday nights, we're going to come back together as a group of intergenerational folks, and we're going to dive a little deeper into what Paul talks about and how he challenges us in our own faith and how we can apply those things to our own lives. And we're going to do this in a fun way. The reason I'm an Olympian, well, no, the reason we're doing this is because I'm an Olympian. But we want to do the Olympics, striving for the prize. That's going to be our theme for this summer for Sunday night. And we're going to divide into teams of about 8 to 10 people each. Only rule is you have to have 3 generations of folks on your team. So I want you to go ahead and start thinking about who you want on your team. But it has to be at least 3 generations, and it's 8 to 10 people on your team. And we're going to do a lot of different contests and competitions, and there'll be something for everybody. So each week there'll be something new. We'll also have food and fellowship at that time, along with the Bible study that we'll have each week. I hope you'll make plans to join us for this. It'll be all summer long. We'll kick it off in June 26th, and we'll do our closing ceremonies on August 28th, right before we kick off our fall season for small groups and Sunday school. So go ahead and start thinking about who you want on your team, and let's get excited about the Olympics for this summer.
All right, thank you. How many kids do we have in here today? All right, raise your hand, kids. How many of you would like to see, or at least like to race Miss Pam McSwain in the 50-meter dog paddle? Would you like to do that? All right. Hey, listen, kids, we have a pool party, end of the year pool party coming up for you. So be paying attention to that. If you're visiting with us today and you have kids that would want to participate in that, that is for kids, all right? So adults, if you show up, you have to be a lifeguard or bring a lot of good food, right? So this is a good time for our kids. And then guess what happens in July? You know what's going to happen in July? You know? VBS, that's right. We have Vacation Bible School happening here in July. I want to just share a little video about Vacation Bible School that's coming up and just encourage you on your way out. I did tell you to race through that foyer. Pause just long enough to go over to the table there where VBS is. They need some donations. It needs your support in volunteer service and all of us to support Vacation Bible School in prayer. Can we do that? Hey, we like prizes, all right? There we go. So pre-register, you get entered into a drawing. Watch this video about Vacation Bible School coming up.
Fossils. Rocks. Vacation Bible School. Join us for a boatload of excitement at Ocean Commotion. You'll dive deep into the biblical account of Noah and the Great Flood found in Genesis. You'll uncover the truth about fossils and rock layers. And you'll learn that just like Noah, you can rely on God to help you stand for God. Trust God. Obey God. Thank God. And fear God. Grab your dive gear and get ready to jump into an ocean of fun at Ocean Commotion Vacation Bible School.
All right, let's sing I Believe in Jesus. Love this song. There's a lot of things in there. Each one of the choruses starts off with I believe. So good stuff here. Let's sing.
Thank you.
singing. Let's continue on this song. You may have heard this on the radio a bit, but even if you haven't heard it, listen to all the words that are in this. Sing this song with us. There's a lot of great words that just really tell about how I can live on this crazy earth through the love of Jesus Christ. The title of this song is called In Christ Alone. In Christ Alone. The words on this song, all right? No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. Let's sing it. Here we go.
No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my death. You keep
that we sang there at the end, No Power of Hell. That's pretty powerful. That's pretty powerful. But no power of hell, no scheme of man, which can be manipulated, which can trick us, scheming. But no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Amen. Let this song just come over you. Let this song speak to you, okay?
Surrender your life.
Through a lot of challenges during our week. This song is just really saying very simply, He's more than enough. Whatever you're going through, whatever the challenges are, He, capital H-E, God, is more than enough. Sing this song with us. Remind yourself how awesome God is in this context.
More than this tiny trial, more than this minor mountain, more than this giant that I see, deeper than any ocean, sweeter than any fountain,
here it is.
Your grace is fine.
that's why we're here today, because we believe that God's awesome power and strength, that the power and presence of the Holy Spirit that He promised us, that Jesus Christ, our Savior, who was and is today and will continue to be, is more than enough. More than enough. Let's pray right now. Father, we just thank You so much for that fact. Father, we thank You for giving us an opportunity to, sure, gather into Your house and to fellowship with one another and to have a good time and even celebrate friends and celebrate being together and just have some joyful time of dressing up. It's all good and fun and great time together, but the most important reason that we gathered here today is to worship You, is to open our hearts and our minds to hear from You so that we too would know. We'd leave here with a fresh sense of that reassurance that You are indeed more than enough, that Your word is true, that what You've promised us is true, and You'll never let us down. No matter what life throws at us, You are indeed more than enough. So we ask right now that You would just, again, speak to us now. As we open Your word, that You would just open our hearts and our ears and help us to be attentive to what You would have us to hear this morning. We ask this in Your name. Amen. Amen. I want you to picture, just imagine growing up in a small town and not a whole lot of exciting things taking place and just any other day. And you wake up and just to start your daily routine and you start to hear the buzz of word getting around the small town. Kings Mountain is not a giant booming city, so I know, I've been in restaurants around here with some of you, and you can't even get a bite in because you know everybody that's coming through. So if you're from Kings Mountain, just imagine you just wake up on any normal Kings Mountain day. But you're starting to hear. Maybe a neighbor says something to you. Hey, did you hear who's come to town? Maybe you see people heading by with their bags packed and maybe like pulling a wagon or, you know, have a little cooler, and they're definitely going out to wherever this person is coming. And so you start to gather your stuff and you start to tell your friends and get your family to gather around, and you're like, hey, I heard he's coming to town. We got to get going. And so you start to make your way. And you're heading to where the crowd is going. And you're all excited because you've heard great things about this person that is coming to town, and you're starting to get excited. But you notice off in the horizon heading towards you a vehicle that you've never recognized before either. And you start to watch it as it draws closer, and you're like, yeah, they don't belong here either. That vehicle must have cost a ton of money. Like, they're not from around here pulling in a vehicle like that. And you're like wanting to get people's attention that are heading this direction off to hear from this great leader that is coming to town. And you're like, hey, look over here. Are you not seeing over here? And the vehicle slows, and a group of people gather around the vehicle, and obviously it doesn't take you long to recognize, like, whoever is in that vehicle has an entourage. Like, I think I'm pretty cool, but I've never traveled with an entourage, right? And they're helping this person out of the vehicle, and you start to see from a distance, you're like, no, that can't be. You've only heard stories about this person. You're like, this famous, very wealthy, obviously, just judging by the vehicle, but then you see him get out of his vehicle, and you see him surrounded by his entourage, you think you start to put some pieces together, like, I've heard about this guy. Our little town, and he shows up today? And you're trying to get people, do you notice who's here? And they're so fixated on getting to this location and seeing this other famous person. Your simple little town. You wake up on a normal day, and you're just flooded with celebrities. Melissa and I and the kids are from Mooresville, so this is how we live all the time in Mooresville, right? When we have people come to visit, I've told you those stories. Like, my mother-in-law likes to try to embarrass me in restaurants. Like, do you know who that is? I'm like, yes, and he doesn't want you to know. He's trying to eat dinner. That's Larry McReynolds. Go. I'm like, so? You guys don't even know who that is, do you, right? Who is that guy? I guess he's a big in NASCAR, according to my mother-in-law. To me, he's a neighbor, right? But this small town, just like two celebrities showing up. So now you're starting to sit back and watch it because, like, what is going to happen? Like, my mind is blowing right now thinking about two people that are gathering this kind of a crowd, but people aren't even noticing. This rich, very famous guy just climbing out of his very expensive vehicle. And so you watch as that famous guy begins to make his way in the same direction that the crowd is already going. And in your mind, you're like, why wouldn't the crowd turn around and head his way? Like, he is legit. Do they not know who's here? And as he starts to catch the crowd begins to part because they're not willing to stop, but they recognize, oh, yeah, we know who you are, and they make way. They're like, sure, go ahead. And so you catch up because you just don't think that these two celebrities can exist in the same place. You think it's just going to be this awesome confrontation, right? There is no way that they can exist in the same place and arena. And so I'm going to go get a bird's eye view. I'm going to get in real close and watch as this crowd begins to part, and they let this guy go through. And you're like, I've heard rumors about the guy that they're all going to see, but I know who this guy is. I mean, he could buy all of us. He could write into effect some bills and laws that would affect us. Like, I'm a little nervous here. I feel like we should stop what we're doing and pay more attention to him. And you're confused as the crowd continues to part, and you watch, and you think, for sure, this wealthy, rich, very influential man is going to approach this guy that is taking away his thunder, stealing his thunder, and drawing a larger crowd than him. And you can't wait to see how this confrontation ends, so you've got to start getting in real close. And you're just baffled. When you see this young, rich guy with all that swag, all that popularity, swag, Fran, that is, let me see, okay. I was going to try to help you out. I was trying to think of how I could help you out with that, Fran. But you know, that's good. And your mind is blown even more when you see him approach this guy and he starts to quicken his pace. And he goes from kind of a walk to a jog. And then when he sees this other cat real close, he's on a full-out sprint. And I'd show you, but these are nice pants. And I would imagine he just runs and he slides in on his knees with his hands up just saying, like crying out, what in the world is he saying? Does he not know who he is? Why is he approaching at such great speed and sliding in on his knees and just crying out to this guy, like, what's happening here? And I'm sure the crowd must have been stunned. And we know if you read through Scripture that they indeed were stunned. Because that guy that he was racing to see was Jesus himself. And he was drawing crowds everywhere he went because Jesus brings healing. Amen? And he brought healing everywhere he went. Everybody he touched was different. Their lives were changed. And Jesus was starting to draw a bigger crowd than this rich young ruler. And this rich young ruler knew that Jesus had something that he did not. And he wanted it desperately. So desperately that he fought his way through that crowd. And the crowd actually, when they saw him coming, began to part because they knew who he was. They recognized that he was a man of great authority, that he had great wealth and great power. And so they let him through, and he races to get to Jesus and falls on his knees and cries out. If you have your Bibles with you, I want you to read along in Mark, the 10th chapter. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all mention this guy, and they mention him in different ways, so we have pieced them together. Luke mentions the fact that this young man is indeed a ruler. Matthew and Mark mention his age, and all three mention his wealth. So you combine them all, and we know that this man was a rich, young ruler. I want you to hear his words as he approaches Jesus that day. Mark, the 10th chapter, beginning in verse 17, it'll also be on your screen. As Jesus started on his way, A man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered. "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not give false testimony. Do not defraud. And you need to honor your father and mother." "Teacher," he declared, "all these I have kept since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him and loved him. "One thing you lack," he said, "go sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard is it for the rich to enter the kingdom of God?" The disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus said again, "Children, how hard is it to enter the kingdom of God? It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, "Who then can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "With man, this is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God." Peter said, "We have left everything to follow you." "I tell you the truth," Jesus replied, "no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in the present age." That's homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields, and with them, persecutions. And in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last first. The rich young ruler. They don't give you a lot of backstory, but I think you can read between the lines by the fact that he is indeed a ruler at a very young age. Which then would mean that his father no longer was capable of ruling. More than likely, no longer was living, right? At a young age, he had assumed great power. And with that great power came a fortune that his family had left him. He was young, powerful, and rich. And in the disciples' eyes and the community's eyes, therefore he had favor with God. That's just the way society was back then. Doesn't seem too different today, does it? We seem to think that these people that have just great influence and money and celebrity status, that God must certainly be blessing them and just raining down on poor, miserable preacher boy. And whatever else you guys do when you wake up in the mornings and realize there's not enough money in your bank account to live that lifestyle, right? That's how we think. We put them on pedestals. But back in Jesus' time, there was no pedestal. That literally was how people thought, including the disciples, because I'm sure they were a part of that crowd that said, "Whoa, here comes so-and-so, that rich young ruler. He's got an in with God, therefore he's got an in with our main man Jesus here. Get out of his way." That's how he was able to run up to Jesus in the first place. You've heard about the crowds that were gathering around Jesus. I mean, people had to climb trees to see him, right? And then got invites back to their house because they had to feed Jesus. Thousands showed up and were starving. And Jesus had to break bread of a little boy and bless them. Like, there were crowds. Have you ever been to Disney World? How about that? You don't even know Larry McReynolds, but if you've ever been to a NASCAR race, I don't go. Because they're a lot of fun to watch them go around and around, but then that crowd has to leave. And I can't stand sitting there for 5 hours to get home. Amen? All right? Don't go. Watch it on TV. It's better. You can see replays of the wrecks, man. It's not hot. There's always, my wife attracts the crazy people when we go to races, and they just sit around us. And she's one of them. It's crazy. She gets real crazy. I love you, though. One race. They won't let her back. crowds. I've been in those crowds. We have been, Melissa and I have been in those crowds where for a moment we thought we've lost one of our kids and they were only like a foot away, but we couldn't even see them around people. And I'm telling you, you're not running to find them, right? Have you ever been there? You know what I'm talking about. How in the world does this guy run up to Jesus, fall to his knees, and cry out? Because they thought he was the man. He had an in with God. Get out of his way. He inherited great wealth from his family. I love the language that he used. What must I then do to inherit what you're offering? I don't know about you, but you don't have to work that hard for an inheritance, right? So I think even in his question, he's like, I don't want to do a whole lot, but what, you know, just give me, point me in the right direction. Because listen, he's made some deals. He's taken that wealth and he didn't squander it. He was wealthy even at his age. I'm sure he's seen some stuff. So he's, I'm sure, got pen, licking the pen, has got his paper out. Just tell me, Jesus, what's it going to be? What do I need to do today to inherit what you got? I've already got everything else here. I like what you're selling here and what you're offering. So just tell me, what's it going to take? And the disciples are looking around like, this guy's crazy. Dude, you're rich. You already got it. Why'd you even come running up here in the first place? Skinned your knees all up, sliding down, begging Jesus. You got your contract out there. You're wasting your time, man. You already have it. That's what they thought. Jesus loves him. Jesus loves him. In my mind, I think he had eyes that looked like Puss in Boots. You ever seen that movie? You ever watch those eyes he has? They're just like, I mean, they're just, what? Like, seriously, I'm not a big cartoon guy, but I'm like, man, I'm like shedding tears. Like, I honestly think Jesus looked at him with those eyes, and he's just melting you, and he takes the man in his face and just, you know, just squeezes his face and so gently, and just like, oh, man. I mean, he loved him. The disciples recognized that and how Jesus' body language was going, and just the way he looked at him, they're like, whoa. Something's about to happen here because that is love. Jesus says, I'll tell you. I'll tell you what you can do to inherit my kingdom and to have everlasting life and to live beyond measly little earthly treasures, but can live with me throughout all eternity. And eternity starts today right here on this dusty ground. I'll tell you what you can have. I want you to go and sell everything you have and give it to the poor. Then I want you to come follow me. See, I think for a moment, the go and sell everything you have to the poor probably didn't bother that rich young ruler that much. I've been around wealthy people, okay? I've rubbed elbows with wealthy people. I have seen in my bank account when I've had more than some of my wealthy people in my bank account. But that's as far as my wealth goes is in my bank account, and they have other deals on the horizon, so they're not worried, right? And I guarantee you for this rich young ruler, sure, I'll just make more tomorrow. I could sell it all off today and give to the poor. Done. But follow you. What does that entail? And he looks around, right? You remember those guys that Jesus called? Some of them have some pretty sweet professions. Now they probably were stinky, looked like they hadn't eaten in a while. Certainly could have used a good night's rest, right? These guys didn't have a palace to lay their head down at night. He's like, wait a minute, weren't you a tax collector? And I know you had a pretty sweet fishing outfit going on. You had how many boats going, and you were hauling in all kinds of stuff. What is going on? I have to be like these guys? And give up that potential of me earning and doing great things? I don't think so. And he left sad, miserable, recognizing that he wasn't going to win today. He couldn't get what Jesus had. He refused to give it up and to let go. Jesus turns to the disciples and he says, how hard is it for rich people to enter the kingdom of God? I know you've heard it preached down through the years and churches have said, so that's why you can't be rich, right? So just unload all your wealth into the offering plates when they go around, right? Because that's how we need you to live. I don't want to burst your bubble today, but there are a ton of rich people getting into heaven, okay? Jesus didn't care about your money. He said, it's not your money, though, that's going to buy favor with my Heavenly Father or with me. Earthly possessions and money don't mean a hill of beans to us. You can have them or you don't have to have them. It doesn't matter. We don't care about money. That's not getting you into heaven. And matter of fact, it would be easier to take the largest animal that you have seen in your life, okay, and read through historical accounts. They've used this same metaphor with elephants. But these disciples weren't hanging around elephants because they were in that part of the world where they had camels. It would be easier for this camel, the two-hump variety, that's a big one, to make it through that sewing needle. Luke, you have one of those, right? You've sutured up some people before in the medical profession. You know, Peter, you've seen it, right? You've had to fix your nets. That needle with a little tiny eye that I have horrible vision. I can't put a thread through it, so how in the world am I going to drive this big old camel through there? Oh, bright idea. Right, Becky Collins, there's a bright idea. You can't. It's not going to happen. Now, I know you've heard the sermons where, oh, but the eye of the needle is really a gate entering into the wall. Have you heard that one before? I'm sorry. It wasn't. Okay? There wasn't a gate that somebody just forgot to build too big. I don't understand why anybody would want to build a wall and just like, guys, watch this. Come here, watch how low this camel has to get through here. I know we've preached that, and it makes good sense because we have to humble ourselves. But this literally meant there was no special gate or some kind of a valley that a camel had to go through, that it was not an inside joke with Jesus and the disciples. He literally meant a big honking camel and that little needle, and whoosh, the camel's going through it. And they're like, it ain't happening. Why isn't it happening? Because with us, it's impossible. Did you know that? It's impossible. I don't care how good you are. I don't care how much money you're dropping in the plates. I don't care how good your attendance is here at church. I appreciate you loving on me, but that's not going to get you into heaven either. Thank you for taking care of my family, and I appreciate it, and I might buy you lunch, but I can't get you a one-way ticket to heaven. I can't help you. I say it to my kids. Kids, you cannot pull out the preacher card. I tried it. My dad's a preacher, so I can be wild. Because I'm getting into heaven anyways. How good did that work out for me? Right? You can't do it. They believed you could. They believed that certain amounts of money, certain amounts of prestige within the community, certain amounts of good deeds were going to get the job done. Nope. Jesus said, I tell you what, I have a deal for you. Let's make a deal. I'm going to totally blow up what society has been saying about getting into heaven. I'm just going to destroy that. Let's prove them wrong. You're probably the wealthiest guy I've met in a long time. Get rid of all of it. Get rid of all of it. And then come join these band of ragtag dudes living out under the stars, going around healing people left and right, going around sharing the good news of the gospel. These guys see people raised from the dead. You can come join this crowd. And you can learn what it means to be a true disciple. And you can learn about my Father that has sent me to show you. I'm going to blow that all up, right? I got a great deal for you. Darth Vader, I apologize, man. I hoodwinked you on that deal, right? You got all excited about bag number two is going to hold something good. I'll buy that lint roller off of you later, though. That looked good. But we always get suckered into the better deal, right? I know if you're visiting with us today, we don't always dress up and act crazy like this on Sunday. I'm crazy every Sunday, but this crowd is a very well-mannered, good-looking, well-dressed crowd. I promise you. So if you're visiting with us, don't let them scare you away, okay? I can't promise what I'm going to say or do every week. I just can't. I'm sorry. Because I get so excited what God has to say. Because I know that he's made this deal. And I know it sounds scary. Because I love to take hold of stuff and control it myself, right? Listen, I got one that is a few months away from driving. Ooh. Right? I'm exhausted. Last night, 3 a.m. I'm going to just tell you this real quick story. Because I got a little bit of time before the barbecue's ready anyways. Last night, sound asleep, 3 a.m. We were here till 9:30 last night. Somewhere, I don't know. We were here. It was a long day yesterday. And we don't live in Kings Mountain yet, so we drive an hour home. We got home. We crashed. Sound asleep. I have a rule in our house. I have two rules in the house. No inside pets, right? That rule's not going so well, because we have a dog named Margo that lives inside. Nobody listens to me. Nope. Friend. Nobody listens to me. So Margo, she's a good little medium-sized Australian cattle dog, a red heeler. She is pretty. Don't tell Margo I said that. Pretty dog. She and I just don't see eye to eye, because I think she needs to be out there, and I need to be in here. This is my palace, right? So she's sleeping in our house, but not in the bed. And that is a rule that so far is good. Unless I'm out of town, then I know that rule is broken too, right? 3 a.m., we've been packing stuff in our house and taking things off of walls, but we didn't move the large mirror hanging over the mantle that is just a few paces outside of our bedroom door. 3 a.m., we don't know what it was, but we hear this horrific crash. Boom! Like that, and I sit up kind of on my elbow, like, what in the, and before I could even get whirled out, wham, I'm like eating my dog's face, like this. Margo, shaking. Melissa, shaking. Me, shaking. All dog right here. I'm like, Margo, get off of me. Scared to death. I was. Where was I going with this, Melissa? You got to help me out with that. I just completely lost where I was going with it. Oh, my word. I was telling you a story about the dog and something. Yeah, the boom, and I don't know. I just lost where I was going with it. You guys got a good story out of it, but I have no idea where I was just, I was tying back into. Oh. Thank you, Donna. I'm exhausted today. And I don't even remember why I start stories. But I asked my 15-year-old son to make sure he had his wallet so that when we leave Friends Day, he can drive home. I like to have hold of that wheel when I'm driving. I like to have hold of that wheel when I'm a passenger at times. And when you have a teenager behind the wheel, I like to have hold of the wheel, the pedals, their eyeballs, their brain. I'd like to get a hold of all of it, right? That's hard for me. And if you've been there, parents that have had teenagers go through this, if you've been there, that's hard. I'm going to tell you something about my personality because I'm a human. It's not my first nature in ministry to say, go with it. You got it. Because I want to make sure, I just want to, my humanness, okay, I want to come behind and be like, I don't know, I mean, Kim and Carrie are going to do a great job with VBS, but maybe I should just see what's on the table and what they got going, right? Pam had to call me out publicly in front of all of you when she was standing right here. Said, I got this. I'm like, yes, ma'am. What if she forgot to tell you that one part about intergenerational, or she missed my favorite part, food? Like, she might not have mentioned food. We want to hang on. We want to control things. And let me ask you this morning, how's that working for you? How's it working? I'm telling you right now, the biggest messes I've ever been in my life were at these great hands. Mine. I'm just a mess. I'm a hot mess. And when I'm left to my own devices and Melissa's not watching out for me, it ends badly, right, Melissa? It's rough. But yet I want to keep hanging on. It doesn't make sense. The rich young ruler had everything. He's that guy. You get invited to his party. What do you get for the rich young ruler who has everything, right? He was that guy. He had it all. What else did he need? What Jesus had. But he couldn't let go. I want to tell you something this morning, and we're going to close. I believe that Jesus' ministry was successful because he went around and he healed. And he touched people's lives and they physically were changed. And I'm telling you right now, I've witnessed with my own eyes, you want to see somebody come to know the Lord in a quickness, let them get sick. Let them get to where they are, their body's at war with themselves and they're shutting down. I see it all the time. Let them feel afraid for their very life. How many of you remember living through 9/11? The greatest church attendance happened that very next Sunday, amen? And I want to tell you something. If you are sick, if your body is shutting down, and if you feel like your life is at its very end, Jesus can and will heal. I'm not promising you that you'll be free from whatever it is that's taking your life here on this side of heaven, but I'm saying he can come into your life and he can restore you from the inside out, and he can give you a peace that passes all understanding, and he can give you this wonderful comfort as you journey from this life to the next. He can do that, and he also can come in and literally physically heal you in a moment. I've seen that. Praise God, and if you're there, I want to pray with you this morning, and just I want to make sure that you're blessed and you understand, but I want to talk to a group of people that aren't there. I want to talk to those people that aren't associated with that big mass of people that are like, oh my goodness, this guy's bringing healing. Well, let's go get cousin so-and-so because he's got that messed up foot, and let's go get, you know, what about our neighbor here? She's been demon-possessed for a long time. I know it. She's crazy, right? I mean, those are those people that were following Jesus. They were bringing them from all around because they had all kinds of ailments. Right? But I want to talk to you people that have it all together. I want to talk to you people that are sharp. I'm educated. I'm rolling in a 2007 Chevy Impala. That thing is sweet. When I cut it off, I have a broken thing in the air conditioning vent, and it goes, that thing is bad. I got a cool $300 to get me through till probably Thursday. In my account, take that. I got a hot-looking woman that's going to a sock hop after this service. That's my wife there in a poodle skirt, right? I'm a preacher. I want to talk to you guys that are like that. Like, I'm not sick. I got this. I can handle it. Can you? Can you? How's it working for you? I'll invite the worship team to come. We invited some friends to Friends Day, and they're playing baseball today. Because we got to make sure our kids make it to the pros, right? So we invest a ton of money and a lot of time to get them into baseball. And they couldn't make it today with baseball, and we sat last week in their home. Literally, I will work the rest of my life in ministry and never raise that kind of money to buy this home. There is a lot of zeros behind the one and the two that this home is valued at. I have been with the husband and his family in his environment. And he's very famous, and I've watched people come up to him literally while we've been having meals and ask for his autograph. I'm like, dude, I'm a preacher. They don't ever care. It never works. Never works. Never works. They have children that literally came out of a catalog. Good-looking kids. And they're sharp. In the world's eyes, they have a lot going. And I watched my wife last week, Memorial Day, actually, had us over for dinner, and I'm out barbecuing with the husband, which, by the way, he's got a grill that's like built in, and it's all the stonework around it, and they got the pool that has the water, the hot tub above it, and the waterfall goes down, like on MTV Cribs. I'm like, what? This is crazy. And we're outside, and the kids are in the pool, and I'm sitting there barbecuing, and I look up, and I'm like, what are the women doing? And they're just crying, tears rolling down their face, and hugging each other. I'm like, I didn't do it, man. And the husband's like, what is your wife doing? This is, what have we gotten ourselves into? Melissa's in there talking to her. Because you can have a lot of stuff. You can have a lot of things. People can think you're all that. People can want to be you when they grow up. And it's still not going to satisfy the emptiness that's right here. That emptiness that the rich young ruler desperately wanted to fill, so much so that he was willing to, he didn't care what people thought, he was running after what Jesus had, sliding in on his knees, begging him, please, what do I need, man? This stuff's not enough. Jesus gave him the same deal that you get today. Let go of the stuff. I'm not asking you. Don't go cashing in your bank accounts and selling your cars or anything like that. But if you do have a good deal on a car, I got an almost 16-year-old, let me know, okay? But I'm not asking you to do all that. Jesus wasn't asking the rich young ruler to give all that up. He was saying, let go of what you think. Let go of the fact that you think you can do good enough to get into heaven. Let go of the fact that you think you can attend enough church to get into heaven. Let go of the fact that you think you can be friends with a pastor and that's just going to be good enough. Let go of the fact that you think your mom and dad can be Christians and that's going to get you by, kids. It's not going to work. Let go of all of that. And trust me. Follow me. So as the worship team sings this morning, I don't know where you are today. Maybe you are that person that's like, look, I'm at my wit's end, and I need some healing today, and I would love it if you would pray over me. I will anoint you even with oil. We'll have people come and lay hands on you. You just let us know. Come and kneel at this altar. That's great. Or maybe, just maybe, you're that person that, by all accounts, has it all together. You didn't even have to dress up in a costume today because you're that cool. That's okay. Because I'm telling you right now, you can't be classed up enough to make it into heaven. You've got to give it all up. Sure, you can go home to your money and your cars and your status, but in your heart, you've got to recognize, God, it's yours. I don't need it. I want to follow you. And if that's you today, man, I'd love to pray with you. I got a whole slew of people in costume and out of costume that want to pray with you today. Because we don't want you to miss this tremendous deal before you leave here today. Let's stand. We're going to sing. And if God leads you, just come on down. I'd love to spend some time in prayer with you this morning. Well, I sure am glad you made it out for Friends Day. You stayed in this cool sanctuary and worshiped with us today. I'd love to fellowship with you, get to meet some of you afterwards. So let me encourage you, if you can. We have lunch down in the pavilion. I think it'll be ready at 12. I tried to go to 12, but we're not even close. So stay here where it's cool, okay? Visit for a little bit. Be sure to see the Vacation Bible School on your way out. By the way, Fran, come down here real fast before I let this crowd go. If you are visiting with us today and AARP sends you stuff in the mail, this is your lady. She heads up our prime timers here, okay? That's for all you old people. I'm just kidding. No, prime time is for 50 and older. They do a lot of fun stuff. In your worship folder, I believe your next event is already posted in there for them. But Fran would like to see you. Okay, so we got all stuff going on. I would encourage you to come back. Not tonight, by the way. Our regular attenders don't come back tonight for our life groups because we're going to be here all day. So just hang out all you want. And Fran's going to preach and pray a little later in the afternoon to wrap it all up, right? They have a Bible study?
Yes, but could I?
And that's all I needed from you.
No, Fran.
Yes, ma'am. $20. $20. See me later. I'll give it for you. If you are visiting with us, we do have a lot of fun here. I know some of you are from other churches, and we love you and your church, and we want to bless you today and want you to know thank you for being here. Thank your church for letting us borrow you for a little bit if you attend another church regularly, okay? That's all right, because we are about a community, right? How many of you believe that? The kingdom of God does not have denominations in it, right? We are all one big happy family that want to follow Jesus. And I feel like we have our hearts clear today so we can go out and do it. So let's pray. I'm going to let you follow that big muscular wrestler in the back. He's going to point you the right direction. That's you, Jeffrey McSwain. You just point him out to the Vacation Bible School table down in the pavilion if you want to join us for lunch. Let's pray. Father, thank you again for this day, for your love, and for allowing us to be here to worship together. And we pray right now that you would bless this food to nourish our bodies and our time of fellowship. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Amen. Hey, before we sing, can I make a deal?
Yes, sir.
Can I see if I can make a deal?
Yes.
Blaine, that echo You buy it on Amazon for $180. Let's make a deal. I'll give you a check for $180 if I can walk away with it.
Blaine, that's a pretty good deal.
Blaine, you either have the Echo or you can have $180. Come on, what is it going to be? You want the Echo? It's called Alexa. You'd have to talk to Alexa all the time. You want Alexa,
hey,
or do you want a check for $180?
Are you saying Blaine's afraid to talk to a piece of computer equipment there named Alexa?
I am.
Okay, that's fair enough. There you go. Grandma wants a gift bag.
Come on, Blaine.
Come on, Christy.
You want Alexa or $180? I need a decision now. You're going to keep it.
All
what
right.
a deal.
Hey,
oh.
By the way, if you did get a prize, they were ordered on Amazon. You could see me, and I do have a gift receipt. You can turn it in, but Gary really wants an Amazon Echo. So
yeah.
See me if you got a prize. I'll be more than happy to give you that gift receipt. You can get cash money in the mail, I guess, or sometime
later. All right,
later.
Mighty is our God. Let's sing as we go out, all right? Sing it out loud. Here we go.